Hello everybody, welcome to this Link and Learn that will provide you an introduction to the money market fund regulation. So today I will be presenting. My name is Fabien De Kayne. I am a director within the Financial Industry Solutions by Luxembourg, and we will be presenting with Ian Kelly, manager in financial service of our Irish practice, and Becky Sharp, manager as well in the financial service department within our Irish practice. Today's agenda will consist first to have an overview of the MMF regulation. It will be MMF regulation at a glance. Then we will provide a deeper attention to some specific key attention points of the regulation. We will as well comment the latest ESMA publication, and then we will address conclusion and key messages of this Link and Learn. So, this presentation is designed to give you an introduction overview of the context of the money market fund regulation, the overview of the different roles and features of MMF money market funds under composition, the main ideas behind the different sections of the regulation, a broad understanding about what is addressed under the release of the latest ESMA publication. Let's now have a look and address the MMF regulation at a glance. The financial crisis of 2007-2008 showed that money market funds can be vulnerable to shocks and may even spread or amplify risks. Investors are likely to redeem investments as soon as they perceive a risk, which can force funds to sell assets rapidly in order to meet redemption requests. This can fuel an investor run and liquidity crisis for a money market fund, potentially triggering negative effects on other parts of the financial system. The regulation is aimed at making these funds more robust, ensuring the smooth operation of the short-term funding market. It sets out to maintain the essential role that money market funds play in financing the real economy. On the 4th of September 2013, the European Commission issued a proposal for a regulation on money market funds with the objective of harmonizing the EU legal framework for MMFs to safeguard the integrity of the internal market and to make them more shock resistant. As an indicative point, the money market funds weigh 15% in the European Union's fund industry, and these figures represent approximately 1 trillion euro. On the 7th of December 2016, the Permanent Representative Committee approved on behalf of the Council an agreement with the European Parliament on Money Market Funds, MMFs. The most up-to-date text of the regulation itself was published for the EU Council on the 26th of April 2017. Additional guidance and technical standards relating to the regulation have been released on 13th of November 2017. Within 10 or 12 months, each member state will have to establish a process for authorizing money market funds in accordance with the regulation. Existing UCITS or IF that invest in short-term assets operate to a longer timetable. They will have 18 months from publication of the regulation to be authorized under the new regime. Scope and timeline of the money market fund regulation. The scope. The scope of the money market funds concern all the undertaking for the collective investment of transferable securities, UCITS, and alternative investment funds, AIFs, that are established, managed, and market in the Union and invest in short-term assets, meaning financial assets with a residual maturity not exceeding 2 years, and have distinct or cumulative objectives offering returns in line with money market rates or preserving the value of the investment. Moreover, we can find under scope of the money market fund regulation all the funds labeled money market funds or MMF. Timeline. The regulation applies directly in every EU member state on 21st of July 2017. Existing money market funds will have to comply with the new regulation by the 21st of January 2019. Regulators are given 6 months to prepare additional guidance and technical standards relating to the regulation. Within 12 months, each member state will have to establish a process for authorizing money market funds in accordance with the regulation. Now we'll just list the key attention points of the regulation. The regulation lays down rules for money market funds, in particular the composition of their portfolios and the valuation of their assets, to ensure the stability of their structure and to guarantee that they invest in well-diversified assets of a good credit quality. It also introduces common standards to increase the liquidity of MMF to ensure that they can face student redemption requests. It establishes common rules to ensure that the fund manager has a good understanding of investor behavior and to provide investor and supervisor with adequate information. The regulation prohibits sponsor support from third parties, including banks. All these characteristics of the regulation are covered with the following key attention points, and we will address them more in detail in this presentation. First one, types of money market funds. Second, eligible assets. Diversification. Internal credit quality assessment. Risk management. Valuation. Liquidity. External support and transparency. I am now leaving the floor to Ian and Becky to move forward and to address in detail the key attention point.
Excuse me, sorry, we had an issue there. My name is Owen Kelly, and I'll run through the roles and features of money market funds. Now, on this slide, we can go through the roles and features of the money market funds. We are speaking about money market funds as one type of fund, but we also note that there are different types of money market funds with different characteristics and different requirements to comply with, as you can see from the table in this chart. There are three categories that we would highlight here: low volatility NAV, public debt constant NAV, and finally, short-term variable NAV and standard variable NAV. The primary differences between these three categories are the thresholds of the minimum daily and weekly requirements, the requirements in terms of weighted average maturity and weighted average life, and the value method used in each category. We can see in the table the different requirements for LVNAV, public debt CNAV, short-term VNAV, and standard VNAV. Beginning with LNAV and public debt CNAV, we can observe that the daily liquidity requirement is to have at least 10% of the assets under management invested in daily assets. This category includes daily maturing assets, reverse repos that may be terminated within 1 day, and cash that may be withdrawn within 1 day. Following the daily requirement, the weekly requirement concerns at least the 30% of assets of the fund invested in the following: weekly maturing assets, reverse repos that may be terminated in 5 days, and cash that may be withdrawn in 5 days. Up to 17.5% of the assets of the 30% weekly requirement can be govies and other public institution bonds with a residual maturity of less than 190 days, and that may be redeemed in 1 day. Continuing with LVNAV and public debt CNAV, regarding the weight of average maturity and weighted average life, the funds of this category have a weighted average maturity of less than 60 days and weighted average life of less than 120 days. Now, the primary difference between the LVNAV and the public debt CNAV is that the LVNAV can be valued by amortized cost if the fund meets the following two characteristics. Firstly, that the residual maturity of the assets has to be less than 75 days. And secondly, that the difference with the market method valuation method cannot exceed 10 bips. Jumping then to public debt CNAV, the valuation method used for this category is the amortized cost. And this type of money market fund has to meet the requirement of having at least 99.5% of assets invested in either government debt, reverse repos, secured with government debt, and cash. Now to speak about the final short-term VNAV and standard VNAV category of money market fund. Following the same structure as we did for LVNAV and public debt CNAV, we can find the daily liquidity requirement of this category of money market funds is to be invested in at least 7.5% of the assets of the fund in daily maturing assets, reverse repos that may be terminated within one day, and cash that may be withdrawn within one day. The weekly liquidity requirement concerns at least the 15% of the assets of the fund invested in weekly maturing assets, reverse repos that may be terminated in 5 days, and cash that may be withdrawn in 5 days. 7.5% of the 15% weekly requirement can be met with money market instruments and other units of other money market funds that may be redeemed within 5 days. Regarding the weighted average life and maturity requirements, short-term NAV has to meet a weighted average maturity of less than 60 days and a weighted average life of less than 120 days. Regarding the standard VNAV, the weighted average maturity and life has to be below 6 months and 12 months respectively. The valuation method used for this category of money market funds is mark to market or mark to model, but the manager of a money market fund should not be allowed to use mark to model when mark to market provides a more reliable value of the asset. On the next slide, we would like to discuss the eligible assets for money market funds. Now, with this in mind, money market funds have some restriction about the universe of assets open to the fund managers to invest in. The characteristics and the investment target of these funds makes them more conservative when selecting the investments. As you can see in this slide, the list that may be chosen includes money market instruments, financial instruments guaranteed by an international financial institution or organization to which one or more member state belongs, eligible securitization and asset-backed commercial papers, deposits with credit institutions, financial derivative instruments, but only if they serve the purpose of hedging interest rate and currency risk, and these should only have, as underlying instruments, interest rates, foreign exchange rates, currencies or indices representative of those categories, repurchase agreements, reverse repurchase agreements, and units or shares of other money market funds. Now, as we see, the composition of the portfolio is subject to diversification in accordance with this slide. The rules of diversification are defined in Article 17 of the regulation and are summarized here, where we can observe that the money market fund may invest no more than the following: 5% of its assets in money market instruments and securitizations, which also includes asset-backed commercial papers from the same issued body. Continuing with the same limit, the VNAV may invest up to 10% of its assets in money market instruments, securitizations, and asset-backed commercial papers issued by the same body, provided that the total of such instruments held by the VNAV money market fund in issuing board in which more invest more than 5% of its assets does not exceed the 40% of the value of its assets. Secondly, 10% of its assets in deposits from the same credit institution, so no more than 10%. Thirdly, 5%, no more than 5% of the aggregate risk exposure to the same over-the-counter counterparty. And then in relation to the last three, the threshold cannot exceed a total of 15% of the assets in any single body, which is an important consideration also. Continuing with the limits, the money market fund shall invest no more than 20% of its assets in securitizations or asset-backed commercial papers. And finally, 15% of its assets is the threshold for reverse repos with the same counterparty. On our next slide, we discuss the risk management considerations. So the money market fund shall comply on an ongoing basis with the following portfolio requirements. Within the risk management requirements, we find a money market fund must select, solicit, or finance an external credit rating and shall only do so within the in accordance with the regulation, and this should be strictly and clearly indicated in the money market funds prospectus and any other communication to the investor that the rating was indeed solicited or financed by the money market fund or the manager of the money market fund itself. In relation to the Know Your Customer policy, the manager shall exercise all due diligence with a view to anticipating the effect of concurrent redemptions by several investors, taking into account at least the type of investor, the number of units or shares in the fund owned by a single investor, and the evolution of inflows and outflows into the money market fund. As regards stress testing, each money market fund will have in place stress testing processes that identify possible event or future changes in economic conditions, which could have unfavourable effects on the money market fund. It is the responsibility of the money market fund or its manager to assess the possible impact of those events or the changes could have on the money market fund, regularly conducting stress testing for different possible scenarios and following the procedures when the stress test reveals any vulnerability of the money market fund. Now, to highlight some key considerations in relation to the valuation rules. As we have mentioned previously, we have some information about the valuation process in our section Roles and Features of Money Market Funds. But it is very important that we just reiterate the main ideas behind the valuation process of money market funds, because its changes depend on the type of money market fund. The asset of a money market fund shall be valued by using mark-to-market whenever possible and on at least a daily basis. This is the case for short-term VNAV or standard VNAV and low volatility NAV money market funds when the fund does not meet the requirements to be valued by the amortized method. Where the use of mark-to-market method is not possible or the market data is not of a sufficient quality to perform such, an asset of a money market fund shall be valued conservatively using the mark-to-market model. The amortized cost method itself may be used for public debt CNAV and low volatility NAV money market funds when the asset of the local volatility NAV money market fund that have a residual maturity of up to 75 days. The units or shares of a money market fund shall be issued or redeemed at a price that is equal to the money market fund's NAV per share. Becky will take us through some of the liquidity considerations.
Thanks, Owen. Just to continue there with the liquidity requirements that the MMS are subject to, money market funds will be subject to new and strengthened liquidity requirements as well as other safeguards. In the case of CNAV and LVNAV money market funds, there are also additional safeguards such as liquidity fees. These are fees that adequately reflect the cost to the money market fund of achieving liquidity, and also redemption gates, which is the suspension of redemptions for a period of up to 15 working days. These will be designed to prevent and limit the effects of sudden investor runs. We'd like to highlight that when within a period of 90 days, the total duration of the suspensions and redemptions period exceeds 15 days, a public debt CNAV money market fund or an LVNAV money market fund shall automatically cease to be a public debt CNAV or LVNAV money market fund. In such instances, they should automatically convert to an LVNAV money market fund or they should be liquidated. Continuing on to external support, when we speak about external support, it means direct or indirect support offered to a money market fund by a third party, including a sponsor of the money market fund that is intended for guaranteeing the liquidity of the money market fund or stabilizing the NAV per unit or share of the money market fund. The external support can be cash injections from a third party, purchased by a third party of the assets of the money market fund at an inflated price or units of the money market fund in order to provide liquidity to the fund. In addition, the issuance by a third party of any kind of explicit or implicit guarantee or letter of support for benefit of the money market fund would represent external support. We are in the last key attention point of the regulation concerning the transparency requirements faced by money market funds. When following the money market fund regulation, the money market fund shall indicate clearly the type of money market fund in the documents directed to investors or prospective investors. At least weekly, the money market fund must make all of the necessary information available to its investors, including a maturity breakdown of the portfolio of the money market fund, the credit profile, the weighted average maturity and life, details of the 10 largest holdings in the money market fund, the total value of the assets, and the net yield of the money market fund. For each MMF, the manager of the money market fund shall report information to the competent authority of the money market fund on at least a quarterly basis, unless there are special cases. Now we're going to move on to the ESMA publications. In this document, ESMA gathers the responses about the concern topics and chooses the preferred one. It is very useful for actors that have to implement the regulation because the responses come from professionals in contact with the regulator and know the market practices when managing the money market funds. The addressed topics in this document are relating to specifying liquidity and credit quality, such as requirements applicable to assets received as part of a reverse purchase agreement, credit quality assessment topics, which include the criteria for the validation of the credit quality assessment methodologies, the meaning of the material change that would trigger a new credit quality assessment for a money market instrument, the criteria for quantification of the credit risk and the relative risk of default of an issuer, an instrument in which the money market fund invests, the criteria to establish qualitative indicators on the issuer of the instrument, such as the reporting timeline containing all the information managers of money market funds are required to send to the competent authority of the money market fund, and the parameters of the stress test scenarios, which include common reference parameters of the stress test scenarios to be included in the stress test managers of MMS are required to conduct. As I mentioned earlier, each money market fund must have in place stress testing procedures. The paper proposes further guidance regarding the general framework of the stress tests, which are to be performed following methodologies and parameters provided by ESMA. For each stress scenario, ESMA exposes the rationale, the methodology, as well as a cost and benefit analysis. For liquidity stress tests, the options are applying the following: either a discount factor to the bid price of each instrument in the fund, or a shock to the observed bid-ask spread of each instrument. For the credit stress test, ESMA proposes either a multiplicative or an additive shock to the credit spread of the instruments in the portfolio. An additional scenario is proposed where the top two exposures of the funds experience a default event. And for interest and FX rates, ESMA proposes a direct shock on interest rate curves, government bond rates, and FX rates. For redemption stress, ESMA proposes reverse stress tests that evaluate the maximum outflows that the fund can generate to face stress redemption scenarios without distorting portfolio allocation, and also the coverage ratio of weekly outflows by weekly liquid assets. An additional reverse stress test scenario is also proposed where the money market fund faces redemption of its two largest investors. ESMA did not outline a specific methodology to achieve macro systemic stress test, but points towards the application of a combination of part or all of the other stress scenarios. All parameters and stress magnitudes would be provided by ESMA to achieve consistency across all money market funds. With regards to calibration methodologies, while ESMA hints towards inspiration from the banking industry, market actors are invited to provide insight on the matter. I'm just going to hand this back over to Fabian now to walk through the next steps related to the regulation.
Thank you, Vicky, for that. So now we will address, as a wrap-up of the link and learn, what are the main next steps forecasted by the regulation. I would say there are four of them. One is not on the slide, but we will discuss it orally. The first one ahead is the date when the regulation applies to the new money market fund, and that will be the 21st of January 2019 for existing money market fund. For the new money market fund, it has been in application since the 21st of July 2017. It is noteworthy to mention that the application for allowing the competent authority to assess whether the UCITS OIF is compliant with this regulation should be submitted no later than 16 months after the date of entry into force. The competent authority has up to 2 months to perform the assessment. One important event that lies ahead of us is the first regulatory reporting that is due by the end of September 2019. Then, last things to comment is that 5 years after the date of entry into force, the money market funds regulation the Commission shall present a report on the feasibility of establishing an 80% EU public debt quota. Proposals to introduce such a quota whereby at least 80% of the assets of public debt CNAV money market funds are to be invested in EU public debt instruments. We are now available. Should you have any specific question on the regulation, we would be pleased to answer them or to analyze them should we dig a bit further the answer.
Hello, it's Moussa Ipala from Schroders. Hello.
Yeah, hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I have a question regarding the T-bills, for example, the eligibility of T-bills under the money market fund regulation. Should we can consider this one as eligible under this regulation? You know that sometimes we have some T-bills, they have short-term life, like 6 months, 3 months. Does one could be considered as issued by a government and also as a money market equivalent?
Yeah, so with respect, so there are various eligibility criteria that have to be met and that are listed in an exhaustive way in the regulation. Should these criteria be met, that TB can be considered as eligible within the money market fund.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Excuse me, do you hear me?
Yes.
Perfect. I have a question concerning the 10% limit for deposits. I think it's Article 17, second subparagraph. Does this limit of 10% also apply for depositories of AIFs?
I'm afraid that, there is an issue with the volume. Could you rephrase the question, whether the 10%?
Yes. My question is concerning the 10% limit for deposits.
Okay.
And my question is, does this limit also apply for cash which is left with the depository of alternative investment funds, so which is not actively placed with any other deposit counterparty, but which the fund keeps at the account of the depositories. Does it mean that not more than 10% can be kept at the accounts of the depositories?
The cash in question is an asset of the fund, correct?
That's right, yes.
So as long as it's an asset of the fund, it's according to me, but we can dig that further. According to us, it's part, it's included in a 10% limit.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay. So thank you all for your attention. We haven't seen any additional questions. Do not hesitate to reach us with the various contact details that you will find on our website. Thank you for your time and for having listened to us. Have a nice end of day. Bye, everyone.